Chineke na nke igwe biko ndike si we napto mure na obo ni Egypt kwe fa we zogo mure bonde bia fa mbode kwen su buzu ke mara din tokare anyi we na jage ma na asigi ni mondo danyi ni anke kele hanso we nye gi nsopru no to na jama mgbe ni ne ni ranye we chose bezu ga anyi wanya na ge farusi obi mure juwe na gozin somu kwa anyi ni ne obi amere ipo bi juwe gba ngoro kwono wani na yana ga to gumade din to anyi we ne to geze bupete nkosi sigi biko batra nyo se anyi maka obi na anegi bo nyanyi ni fo wanya kwisi ala anyi ki we na potande na obu nke ekwensu anyi we na nyego fe na nsopu na ija manasi le kwa ka ndi ru anyi ni ne kakasi si we ba honu ha we ta hapu iku ni ozo obodo ekwensu buzu ala kwa ni yeze bu bede ngozi anyo wani bu mugi we na kpoko ha so ge na sin ne bu gi choze gwezu ga ge anyi we na ajage ma we na eto ge na so nye kere ihe ni ne kere ke mana we nye kere na no tuto ni ne na nsopu ni ne ija manani ne site na ebige ma ro ebi ka na ajoge ise
Welcome, my amazing viewers. Thank you so much for joining me in my program once again. I appreciate you wherever you're connecting from. If you're joining me from Africa, from Asia, from Europe, from America, or from Australia, I thank you very much for your contributions. God bless you. And bless you more. May Chukwuka be able to continue to protect you wherever you are. Whoever you are, may Chukwuka be able to continue to protect you and give you wisdom for you to continue to move forward in anything you are doing to succeed. We will all succeed. Today, I come again to bring you information. Talk about things that are happening in that very country called Nigeria. We cannot be silent, just as I always tell you, that we will tell our stories. Don't allow people to take charge of this story. The media has been telling a wrong story about us for a very long time. They have been passing wrong information for a very long time, and we are silent. Thank God today, the social media has taken charge. We will not allow them to take over the social media. No matter how they try, they will try. They will try their possible best to take over the social media, but we will not allow them, and they will never succeed. They will never succeed. You can see recently the way they have decided to shut down Twitter. And it is not just Twitter. They are going to shut down many other channels on social media that people use to pass informations and get informations about things that are happening. Each time they accuse the social media of fake news. But the place you get the real fake news is from the government and the conventional media. Each time they come out, they will try to change the narrative, try to paint things that are wrong, right? They will try to promote evil. That is why a terrorist apologist, somebody who is promoting bandit, will always be proud on national television to come and promote them and talk on their favor. And nobody does anything about it. But when a man of God comes to speak on behalf of the innocent people, come to speak and bless somebody who is fighting a righteous cause, the DSS invites him. Why will you be praying with Mazi Nnamdi Kanu? I'm talking about Farambaka. Farambaka came out, you know. He came out for the very first time to pray for Mazi Nnamdi Kanu and wish him well. And recognize Mazi Nnamdi Kanu's effort. All hell let loose. They begin to call for his head. DSS invited him. The church came up against him. So many people, even his own people came against him. What did he do wrong? Just because he blessed Mazi Nnamdi Kanu. But you see a terrorist apologist coming on national television on a daily basis to defend them and talk on their favor, even shouting down on people who are calling them bandits and said they should stop calling them bandits. And instead, the government gives him security to move from places to places. Nobody says anything. That is to show you that very contraption is not for diplomacy. It's not for you and I, more especially those from the southern part of Nigeria. Corruption has eaten deep in that very country that it has no remedy. It doesn't matter who becomes the president. It doesn't matter who becomes the prime minister. It doesn't matter who becomes who in that very contraption. So long you stay together in that contraption called Nigeria, it will never work. And so long you are still in that contraption, people like Obasanjo will still have control over you. And those people are the evil men who has made Nigeria what it is, who are so corrupt. Obasanjo, who killed the people of Udi for no reason. You have forgotten. You have a short memory. Who went to Udi to destroy life and kill a lot of people? Today is negotiating with a bandit. Bandit, well-armed bandit, who are calling innocent people. He is negotiating with them. Sheikh Gumi, who is a bandit, is going to Obasanjo to rapport with him and talk with him. And he's praising Sheikh Gumi. That is just to expose to you that very contraption is not for you and I. It's a devilish gathering. Gathering of the devilish people. And those of you who are innocent, it doesn't matter your region, it doesn't matter where you're coming from, that you're innocent, begin to find a way out from that very contraption. support your region and get out of that very place. Break it up. Let's break it up and go our separate way so that these people will lose their grip on all of us. That is the only way we can make them lose grip on all of us. Corruption have eaten deep in any way. You see, recently we saw your Senate, the Senate mapped out 37 billion naira, 37 billion to renovate Senate, 37 billion to renovate Senate. After that 37 billion was given out, the Senate was seen, was it a few days ago, leaking water, water was leaking from the roof of the Senate, preventing the senators to sit. The Senate was leaking, water was leaking from the roof, filled everywhere, the Senate could not sit. After spending 37 billion, an amount that is enough to build a new Senate, a new House of Senate, the money that is enough to build a new House of Senate was used to renovate Senate House, and yet water was leaking. Watch the video. Maybe you didn't see the video. For some of you didn't see the video, I know many people must have seen the video, but those who have not seen the video, watch the video.
National Assembly cleaners worked as the leakage from the rainfall floods the National Assembly lobby this morning.
That is the kind of decay you have in that very contraption. And it is not going to get better any soon. It is not going to get better. If you are deceiving yourself, oh, it's going to get better. It is not going to get better. It will get worse. As long as you belong to that very contraption called Nigeria, it will get worse, worse and worse. Now they are trying to guard the social media, trying to clamp down on the social media, simply because the truth is coming out from the social media. Social media, every social media platform have a means of checking what you post. They have a means of doing fact check on what you post. If you post something that is controversial and something that is not real, once people report it massively, it is going to be taken down. It doesn't matter who you are, they will take it down. This is a place where people express themselves, where human beings express themselves, say it the way they feel it, the truth and nothing but the truth. It's only on social media. But today, Nigeria is trying everything possible to stifle the social media because their president went to social media to promote a hate speech. And the Twitter said, no, you cannot promote such hate speech here. Masses reported that very post, it was taken down, and today it's a different issue. But what are you seeing in the media? You see Nigerian media, the conventional media in Nigeria, coming out to support this very evil act of the president. They come out to change the narrative, asking people questions on that same issue. Till tomorrow they are still asking questions on that, trying to prove the president right, trying to make social media the problem of Nigeria. That is what the media is trying to do now, trying to change the narrative. They are now trying to tell us that the reason why Nigeria is insecure is because of social media. The reason why Nigeria has a problem because of social media. But the Fulani Gen Jawid, who are causing that very problem, causing insecurity in Nigeria, how many of them are in social media? None of them is in social media. They don't know what is going on. The Fulani Gen Jawid, the herdsmen who are in the bush, most of them who are in that bush causing that insecurity are not using social media. They're not even in social media. They are not in social media. But instead of these people fighting the real cause of insecurity, they are changing the narrative in the media, and media is promoting this. I want you to watch one of the interviews that was granted on Channel Television and this very Twitter ban and other social media laws that they are bringing up, so that you can see what they are doing and what they are saying. Each time you are watching all these videos, be very careful. Listen carefully and see how they are trying to manipulate the people and change the view, change the real fact. They try to manipulate and change the fact and make you believe different things. But we will not allow them. Watch the video carefully and listen to what they have to say. Thank God for that. Some people that come to this media, some of them are learned. But some of them, they are learned. In as much they are learned, they are always trying to be politically correct. But for you watching, forget about being politically correct. They will always try to be politically correct when they are talking on that, their conventional media. But for you that is watching those media, watch carefully with your sense intact. You will get the real fact from what they are saying. Let us watch.
As directed by the leadership of the House of Representatives, five committees meet with the Minister of Information, Lai Mohammed, to unravel the circumstances leading to the Twitter suspension and its legality.
The pattern of choice.
The minister begins by explaining the reasons behind the suspension and alleges complicity of Twitter CEO Jack Dorsey in the NSAR's protest.
The same Twitter played a very unsavory role by making available its platform to retweet, not just retweet the messages of the NSAR's protesters, but raising funds for the NSAR's protesters before it was hijacked by hoodlums. Jack Dorsey crowdfunded the activities of NSAR. That's why we believe that Twitter's mission in Nigeria is suspect.
He goes further to quote laws which empowered the federal government to issue the suspension.
But until so incorporated, the foreign company shall not carry on business in Nigeria or exercise any powers of a registered company. That's a section 78(1) of the Companies and Allied Matters Act 2020.
But lawmakers questioned the timing of the suspension, which came just after the president's tweet was taken down, and are also concerned about the negative impact on businesses which depend on Twitter.
The pressure that people have is that the Twitter took down a statement that was made by the president, just like how they took down a statement that was made by Donald Trump of America.
We have to consider the economic detriment of the mass of Nigerian youths who live and survive trading on Twitter, doing so many other things. We did not suspend the activities of Twitter because they deleted Mr. President's tweet. Not at all. Have we taken into consideration Nigerians doing business on Twitter? And the answer is yes. There are other platforms, Facebook, Google Hangout, WhatsApp, for people to use.
The Minister of Information says that the federal government has approved a committee to engage with Twitter, and that as part of the conditions for lifting the suspension, Twitter must first register with the Corporate Affairs Commission and get a license, and that subsequently all the conditions will follow.
Well, the conversation around Twitter and whether or not it's been banned, suspended, why that happened is not going away anytime soon. Don't forget that recently the ECOWAS court had a ruling stopping the Nigerian government from prosecuting those who insist on still using Twitter despite the ban or suspension, whichever one you prefer. But we have with us this morning Mr. Eni Akinshola, who is the advisor, lead publicity executive, Agogo Publishers. You're welcome to Sunrise Early this morning.
My pleasure, Julia. Good morning.
Well, you are an information man, and you have also been on, you've been a journalist, and also you've been on the other side, for lack of a better term to use now, as if there were two sides. But yes, if one were to interpret it in that manner, did you see this coming in terms of government interface with Twitter and how offended it felt when the president's tweet was pulled down?
I think we started on a very wrong footing. I mean, government and Twitter. The issue was not a government thing. It was Mr. of President Muhammad Buhari in his capacity. That tweet was his personal tweet, quote unquote. And if he had issues with Twitter's pulling down, I think the first thing should have been to engage with Twitter, not to suspend Twitter and its activity in Nigeria. Other gaffes followed immediately. Other goofs followed. Where we are today, therefore, is what can we get from it?
Now, I want you to enumerate what you consider the other goofs.
The other goofs was that we saw the Honorable Minister of Information coming to explain some things and then banning, quote-unquote, or suspending. Was it a ban? Was it a suspension? Then the Honorable Attorney General coming to say that whoever uses alternatives will be... These are goofs or gaffes that were unnecessary. Immediately, the ban or suspension was announced. What ought to follow after the first gaffe is engagement with Twitter. How do we do it? Then other gaffes like, okay, we want to regulate OTPs, all these. It's the other goofs and gaffes. those things could come outside of this crisis.
Why do you consider them gaffes?
What I mean is if Twitter did not have any issue with the president, would they have come out? If yes, why did they come out around that point? You see, when you muddle the waters, you create confusion in the populace. There is a poor understanding of your intentions, and people can go run wild with the ideas of what you are trying to do. If government wanted to regulate practitioners in the social media space, it should be an action that will be taken outside of Mr. President's altercation with Twitter. So these are goose and gaffes. But as I've said, maybe it's they have paused, there's a rewind, and maybe they are restarting. But I also saw a lot of funny things. If the group that is to represent Nigeria with Twitter, we should have tech guys who understand how this works, not necessarily political office holders. Maybe a lawyer to fine-tune other things, but tech guys who understand what benefits there are for Nigerians, who understand what opportunities there are for Nigerians, and who could leverage on this opportunity to negotiate what is best for our cyberspace, for our economy, and for our security. But what do we have? People probably don't run their own Twitter account. People probably don't have the most basic knowledge of social media. But that is us.
So it would seem that, well, some people would say that generally, the problem that has been raised, even though the minister, Alhaji Mohammed, continues to insist that it is not because Twitter pulled down the president's tweet, that's the reason why they have clamped down on the social media app in Nigeria. Even though he continues to insist
believe that you believe in other things.
Well, I don't know about you, but that's what he says.
Okay.
There have been problems in general with governments, and not just governments, but let's say governments, countries, nations, those who deal with security and social media. It's not a uniquely Nigerian problem, so to speak. How do you think that, as a developing nation, our problems seem to be a little more compound? I mean, we have brought in security into the matter, and as in Nigeria here, staying as one, secession and all those manner of talks, there are huge fears of that, and the power that social media could wield, and even the power that external forces could wield through social media. What are your thoughts on that as we navigate, as we're moving forward in this technologically driven age?
A very basic thing about governance and information is openness. If we have the right kind of relationship between the government and the governed, the fear of manipulation is drastically reduced. I didn't say eliminated. It's drastically reduced. When government says things, people believe that for what it is. People see government as representing them truly and truly. That's the very basic thing. The other thing is that in societies where there are problems managing social media, they do not manage it on the social media. They go below the radar, get their acts right, get their policies well formulated, get their plans of action well articulated, then take action. But here, we start our own from the public. We voice out, then we begin to think of how we do it. That's the difference. In what way are we going to use the social media to help tackle insecurity? That ought to have been discussed, outlined. The methods ought to be engaged, ought to have been done. In what way are we going to use social media regulation to correct insecurity problems? That ought to have been outlined. But we strike first, then look at the reaction before we think. So that's the difference between us and other societies. If there were no issues between Twitter and Mr. President, and all these things have been outlined, government would have engaged society, interested members of society, core stakeholders, quote unquote, as they are called, and engaged them. This is what we are thinking. Mm. And we discuss. There is an agreement. So when the policy is pushed out, it gets received almost immediately. So it will only be those who have extreme views that will be opposed to it. And those who have extreme view anywhere in society, globally, are infinitesimal part of society. But when you do not engage those who have moderate views, when you do not engage the larger mass those who have extreme views take over this airspace.
In this conversation, I find it interesting, first and foremost, that you keep on saying if Twitter did not have any problems with Mr. President or Mr. President did not have any problems with Twitter, it would seem that you are restricting it to these two people, when it would seem that it is the government of Nigeria that has now taken it on. But in this case, in the situation whereby the president's tweet was pulled down, do you think that was a view? Did you see a problem with that in the first instance?
It's not a big problem. Now, how do social media platforms...
Well, it is a problem.
It's not a big problem. If you pull down my own thing, it's a problem. I'm a citizen. If Twitter pulls down your thing, it's a problem. But it's not a big problem in the sense that such actions take place because people report those accounts. Twitter don't just wake up and take action. If I say something that Twitter, that people feel is offensive, people will report my account to Twitter. And Twitter will look at the algorithm. People will look at the inflow of information on that and take action. That is how it has always been. The same thing for Facebook. So it's when Twitter now takes action, you engage. Hello, this is what we have done. Why is this happening? Over 2-3 hours, that could be resolved. So it's taking down, there are rules of engagement with social media platforms. If you do so, and so number of people flag that, Twitter will act.
Yeah, but in your own analysis, do you think that tweet was problematic?
It's not problematic in that these are private enterprises. There are rules. You come to my platform.
No, I mean the tweet itself, the tweet that was pulled down.
For me, it is. It is because we have a security situation on our hands. It is because we have had instances where much more damage has been done. And the utterances and body language of Mr. President was not that aggressive, was not that poignant, was not that active. It was passive, almost like supportive of those. So, and because we are, quote unquote, a thoroughly, thoroughly divided society, such utterances must weigh the ramifying effect of the outcome. And we had a history, a civil war that has dogged us in terms of, have we really forgotten it? Have we put it behind us? No. Some of the things around the civil war are still resonating with us. So I would think that Mr. President would be a little bit more introspective, a little bit more sober before reading such a tweet. Because we have seen the case of the Tutsis and Hutus. We have seen other societies where utterances trigger things. For instance, the dot thin statement of Mr. President. It looks harmless ordinarily, but it is harmful because we are divided, because we are mutually apprehensive of our actions, of our words, of our inaction. So this is not the time to be reckless, to be unguided in whatever we say or do. This is the time to be deliberately sober. Because this country, and I say this to everybody, I am one of those who believe that this country has a future, but not on the grounds under which we run it. Not under this. We have to rework it. We have to build confidence in the system. We have to believe that the Constitution is for all of us, irrespective of where you come from. And until we do that, utterances like that, rather than be seen on the face value, will be seen for its underlying meanings.
So let's fast forward now from the president's statement, because he did not type that statement initially. It wasn't a statement released like we'll see press statements. It was a conversation in context where INEC officials had gone to visit him and talk about the damage happening to a number of their facilities around the country, but particularly in the southeast of the country. And that's where he made that particular statement. Some people have made a differentiation between the president speaking off the cuff and the manner in which he spoke and when it was written. I don't know if you saw that differentiation. That is there. But then let's fast forward to where we currently are. I mean, according to you, the gaffes and the goofs that have now been made, and now we have a committee to engage with Twitter. But before that time, we saw some people who felt very aggrieved go to the ECOWAS court in the wake of the Attorney General saying they're going to prosecute those who still tweet, even though some people dared and said, Attorney General, we're waiting for you to come and arrest us. Because according to them, there are laws, the laws upon which the Attorney General hopes to rely, which he still hasn't named, seem to be quite spurious. Nonetheless, some people are taking no chances and have gone to the ECOWAS court. Now, that ruling has come out. The Nigerian government says it is considering the ruling. They're still studying the judgment. But then they have begun to question the legality and the jurisdiction of the ECOWAS court. And some people wonder if that kind of court will hold any weight. I mean, the ruling from that sort of court will hold any weight, unless the weight that the members attach to it. What are your thoughts?
Since we are signatories to the protocols of ECOWAS, we are bound by it. But you see, I also don't see...
They're bound by it, but how much weight, how much importance have we attached to the ruling?
The weight we are ready to attach to it.
Indeed.
You see...
So do you think it was worthwhile going to get a judgment from that court?
I think it
knowing
is.
That
it is a good thing, because it's an opportunity to resolve issues rather than to complicate it. And I should think that what government should do is, look, now there's an opportunity to resolve it. Why not latch on that opportunity and say, okay, gentlemen, this is what the courts have said, though we have issues with it, but being Democrats, let us allow it the way, and then we'll walk on from there. It solves a lot of problems. It's a win-win for every one of us. It's a win-win for every one of us. You can even argue that, look, though we do not believe that the judgment is made in good conscience, it's made, you can just say a lot of things, but because we want to douse this tension, because we feel that our people have the right to voice out legitimately, let us move forward. Mm. But we keep on complicating simple things. Mm.
You have had calls to advisors, the head of a subnational government before, especially with regards to handling information. How do you think that, you know, information sometimes gets out of hand and the situation gets beyond control, or it will seem that government is struggling to control it? What are the dynamics that happens behind the scenes?
When there are too many sources, outlets for information, there will be confusion. And I say this with all due respect. There are too many outlets for information for this government. For instance, there was no need for any Attorney General to come out to talk about what the President was handling. The Attorney General should give up legal, verified, constitutionally guaranteed legal opinion when asked. Otherwise, there are media minders of Mr. President who should sit down, plan, and release statements on behalf of Mr. President. Even Mr. President's speeches should be vetted by media minders, and I, with all due respect, there are very good hands involved there. But I don't know to what extent they have been involved in managing of information. I am sure from what I have seen that a lot of people talk out of the media team. From what I have seen, I've seen ministers say things that will end up not being the total truth. Meanwhile, there ought to be a clearinghouse for the information of government. In most cases, when it comes to the government, the Honorable Minister of Information is the one to voice out. But when it comes to the presidency, the principal is the media team, to be represented by who is the anchor point at that point. It could be the special advisor, it could be the senior special advisor, it could be whoever they want. It all depends on the level of engagement. You could make an essay, special assistant, to release a statement on behalf of the presidency. But it must have been well processed. So that why you are engaging an essay is because of the value, the premium you place on who initiated the idea or what information you want to pass across. If it's high state information, then you are likely going to use the special advisor or senior special advisor. So it depends on the synergy within the system. I do not see such a synergy. I may be wrong, but I can tell you there are bright hands that I've seen, that I've worked with as a journalist. And recently I met one of them and I voiced my opinion. And I said, that why are we... I may disagree with your principal on a number of things, but there are some things that I agree with. One, we can't release this country to the hands of people I call Ifunpa, Ibadi, or Tumapo generals. We cannot release this country to the hands of warlords, street warlords. We must take hold of this country and get out of our problems by discussing them. Every war ends in a discussion somehow. Every war. In the religious era, in the Quran, in the Bible, in societies that are as old as time, every war ends in a discussion. So why not discuss before the war? My own thing is that let us engage. When people have issues, instead of demonizing them, engage them. And once you engage and you know that these are unreasonable people, let the society know the level, the extent of their unreasonableness. But we cannot be gravitating aimlessly towards the precipice because we are not thinking and we are not talking.
Have we made a storm out of a teacup with this suspension or ban on Twitter in Nigeria? Some people have said, oh, it's indicative of government's intolerance to opposition. Oh, it's indicative of government's intention to stifle free speech. You know, there have been all manner of things read into this ban on
we
Twitter.
We have not.
But
it is these and more. This, what it is indicative of this, but what is more fundamental?
You believe that it is indicative of that?
This and more. What is more is this. We have failed to realize that the youth content of our population is high, largely unengaged, largely unemployed, some unemployable. Now, but most of these have found space within the social media to get engaged. I know of people who sell things on social media, young people who have no job, people who do network marketing on social media. Now, Twitter is the most active out there for such. And you have cut off their means of survival, their means of engagement, their means of satiating their worries, their anxieties, their pressures. So it is much more than the fact that you are suppressing the right of the people to voice out. You are also suppressing their means of livelihood. People don't see it from that perspective. I know of young people who...
When that was put to the minister, he said, no, they can go to other platforms. There's WhatsApp, there's Facebook, there's Instagram. They can do that.
With all due respect, the minister has a little understanding of this platform. I'm sorry. He's an elderly person and I defer to elders. I'm brought up that way. I'm configured to see elders. But part of the problem is that the minister really do not have an understanding of what is happening. He has informants who are also not giving him the right information or who he's not listening to. You cannot compare Twitter to Facebook or WhatsApp. You cannot. The factors, the reality under which they operate are different. A tweet in 10, 20 minutes can be engaged by a more global audience than a Facebook account. So these are things that I see it as some of the calves that we should not think about. You see, I also heard this thing about we could develop local alternative. My own argument is, it's not when you have a crisis that you start thinking of developing a local alternative. What have you been doing since the art was created? Why not thinking of local alternative? Why not engage these young people? Why not creating an IT hub all across the states and ask people, give them targets, fund them, and say, we want an alternative within such and so period.
So what are your thoughts now on the fact that we're beginning to think of licensing social media handles? I mean, there's been all that kind of argument, and it would seem that it's a valid one, because a number of countries have been raising issue with giants like Google, saying that the advertisements they place in their countries, which are seen in their own countries, that Google needs to pay tax on them. And so we've seen lawsuits whereby these big tech giant companies are forced to now pay tax, you know, in some countries as a result of that. So do you think that this idea of trying to license, you know, big tech in Nigeria would work for them to be able to operate?
I do not see a crime in attempting to make economic gains of this. I do not see a crime. But it must be well-reasoned, well-thought-out plans. You don't do this knee-jerk kind of thing and expect results. You must plan well. What if Twitter and they meet and say, let us discuss it, and you are not ready? You do not even know where you can. So it's a different thing. Let us reason well. Let us plan well before we take actions. I am not opposed to government giving out rules of engagement in the society. But they must be seen to be fair to all. They must not be seen to be born out of malice. They must not be anger-driven. They must be well-reasoned, well-rationed, well-thought-out policies and strategies of government to engage and to benefit for the society. But if it is to benefit, to protect the government against the people, then that is not right. The people should be protected against the government. The people who vested power in the government, and if inseparable part of them, should not be the victims. Why the government, who is there in representative capacity, should be the villain, or should be the one oppressing them. Pardon me. So once we think things out, once we reason them out, our actions will be seen to be altruistic, will be seen to be rational, will be seen to be acceptable to all, will not be seen as vindictive. And that's my argument. If government wants to engage with Twitter, with Google, with all this, let that be. Mm-hmm. But first and foremost, it should not be on this premise, on this basis. Mm-hmm. And let us engage first before we make noise.
You see? What do you think, in this engagement right now, do you think that we have sufficient leverage as a government one? I'm sure, of course, we are a big market for a number of Czech giants, and they should be interested in coming to Nigeria, more specifically, as when you look at our numbers, the youth bulge, and even what's possible here. But do you think that so far, so good, we have the... Are we the kind of people that they can say, look, okay, you guys don't want us here, no problem. We simply black Nigeria out.
No right-thinking business entity will black out anybody. But when the cost of doing business threatens the overall cost of that business entity, you can take a decision to leave. So while we are pushing, we must do a SWOT analysis. We must do an opportunity cost of our engagement. If we drive them out, what do we gain as a society? That is, if you out-negotiate them, we outmaneuver them and they feel that, wow, instead of doing this, we are not going to do it. Let's move out. What will be the loss to Nigeria, to our economy, to our society, to our youth? What will be the implication on our security? What will be on the social tension? Because we're going to release more young people into the society who have been disengaged from what I could call a distraction, quote unquote. They engage now because there is nothing to do, and yet they're making life out of that. They eke out some means of livelihood from it. So you must consider all these options. Because if you try to negotiate with them and it becomes a threat to their business model, they will opt out. So we must factor in all this. That's why I say you need the experts, people who know the nitty-gritty of their actions. It is what you know that can really understand.
So you think that team needs to be reviewed, the team that should engage with...
That team is a political team. That team is not a team that will get much out of, except, you know, if they have a backup team of experts and technocrats. And for me, I think the first thing is the expert and technocrat meeting them first before you put political seal to it. Because when you put your first foot forward, you get concessions that are infinitesimal, concessions that will not add any value to you, and you bring it back home to your technical experts and they tell you you've got nothing.
Well, I'm sure a lot of Nigerians will sincerely hope that will not be the case.
I hope so.
But we have to say thank you so much for
sharing
your thoughts with us this morning. Eni Akinshola is an advisor, lead publicity executive at Google Publishers.
After watching, you can agree with me that all they are planning is to change the narrative, but they will not succeed. We know the truth. Social media is not the cause of insecurity in Nigeria. The government is the cause of insecurity in Nigeria. The Janjaweed are the cause of insecurity in Nigeria, sponsored by the Janjaweed government. They are sponsoring them, they are aiding them, they are paying them, they are providing every cover for them to cause the insecurity. As we speak now, the insecurity happening in the southeastern part of Nigeria and southern part of Nigeria as a whole is caused by Nigerian military. Nigerian military, they are the people killing innocent people in the southeastern part of Nigeria, taking their life indiscriminately. That is what is happening before your very eyes. But the media go blank on it. They don't want to talk about it. We will not allow them to change the narrative. That is why we bring their information and dissect it. We will not allow them. It doesn't matter how they try. They will not succeed. They will succeed. We will continue to voice out. That is why you have to share the video to people who knows, who want to know. Go use your own platform, no matter how big, no matter how small, any platform you have, use it to speak up. Speak out about the situation of the country, the situation of the poor masses. That is what you have to do. That is the only way we can be safe and be alive. Thank you so much for watching from wherever you're watching from. Continue to pray for Mazi Nnamdi Kanu, wherever he is. Pray for him, for God to continue to strengthen him, to continue to give him more knowledge, wisdom, and understanding. I know he is very strong. He's a very strong man, very healthy. Pray for God to continue to keep him for us, continue to give him more life and more knowledge and understanding. Give him more word to give to us so that we can continue to stand strong. Pray for Sunday Igbowo, whatever challenges that is coming to his way, that Almighty God should protect Sunday Igbowo as the Oduduans are preparing for the rally in Lagos on the 3rd. May the Chukwuka Abiyama continue to protect them and make a way. Let that rally be the most successful rally they have ever conducted. That is our prayer for Oduduwa. Oduduwa is here. Oduduwa must come. And Biafra is here already. Biafra is here already. Believe it or not, we are going. They will kill us. We will kill them. At the end, Biafra will come. That is the word of our Supreme Leader, Mazi Nnamdi Kanu. And his word comes to pass because he has been chosen by Chukwuka Abiyama. He never lies. Just as he said, he's as white and whiter than snow. And there's nothing you can do about it. You can be jealous for all I care. He is the chosen person. He is the chosen son of God. He is the chosen savior that we see at this time. Take it or leave it. We are going with him. Thank you so much for watching. And remember this. Bye-bye. See you again on the next video. ¶¶